Before we have our call to worship, I'll just introduce myself to you. I am Candace Arnold, and everybody calls me Candy. The only time I got called Candace was mostly when I did something wrong by my mother. I knew I was in trouble when she said Candace. It is a joy and a pleasure to be here today. I am a Franklin County girl. I was grew up in Orrstown and really never expected to become a United Methodist pastor or a pastor at all until I was probably in my 40s and received a call to the ministry and started pursuing that, and then went to college and seminary and was ordained. And during the time, I had the joy and the privilege of being a pastor. I served a church in Perry County, and then I served in Mechanicsburg, and then back in Perry County, and then in Juniata County. And finally, I served at St. Thomas, where Tim Funk is now the pastor. And I retired there June 30th. And I understand Tim's father was a beloved pastor here for many, many, many years. So it is a joy to be able to share God's word with you today as a visiting preacher and pastor. So we will continue now. I invite you to stand as you're able, and let us join together in our call to worship. The Mighty One, God the Lord, speaks and summons to the earth from its rising of the sun to where it sets. He summons the heavens above and the earth that he may judge his people.
Gather to me this consecrated people who made a covenant with me by sacrifice, and the heavens proclaim his righteousness, for he is God of justice.
We will continue with one chorus of All Hail King Jesus. It's from The Faith We Sing, 2069. Let us pray. Dear Lord, we do praise you this Sunday morning. You are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and we shout hallelujah to praise you. Thank you for all that you provide for us. Bless our time together now as we worship. Bless the reading of your word. And I pray that as I endeavor to preach your word, that your Holy Spirit would give me the words that you would have me say. Help us all to be blessed by both and to take what we hear and to apply all of this to our lives. Speak to us now, Lord, as we worship. We pray this in the name of the mighty God we serve. Amen. We will continue with hymn number 454 in the United Methodist hymnal. Open my eyes that I may see. You may be seated. Our first lesson today, the epistle lesson, comes from 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 3 through 6. These words come from the Apostle Paul to the church at Corinth. And Paul says and writes, "And even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. The God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers so that they cannot see. The light of the gospel, so that they may not see and cannot see the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For we do not preach ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord, and ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who said, 'Let light shine out of darkness,' made his light shine in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Christ." Our gospel lesson today, the gospel for this Sunday, this Transfiguration Sunday, this final Sunday in the season of Epiphany, as we prepare for the journey of Lent that begins on Wednesday, on Ash Wednesday. I'm going to read from Mark's gospel, the information, the telling of what happened on the Transfiguration, the Mount of Transfiguration. "Now after 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John with him and led them up to a high mountain where they were all alone. There Jesus was transfigured before them. His clothes became dazzling white, whiter than anyone in the world could bleach them. And there appeared before them Elijah and Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Peter said to Jesus, 'Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us put 3 shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah.' He did not know what to say, for they were very frightened. Then a cloud appeared and enveloped them. And a voice came from the cloud, 'This is my son, whom I love. Listen to him.' Suddenly, as they looked around, they no longer saw anyone with them there except Jesus. Now, as they were coming down from the mountain, Jesus gave them orders not to tell anyone what they had seen until the Son of Man had risen from the dead." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. Would you pray with me? O Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on us gathered here. Melt us, mold us, use us, Lord, that the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts, that it all might be acceptable to you, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. I must admit that even though I have been a preacher and a pastor for probably over 25 years, it is always a little daunting, I guess, to come before people that you really don't know and to endeavor to preach the Word of God. And I share with you today that I come as just as any one of us come before God's throne of grace, knowing that we are here because God has drawn us here together to worship and praise God. As I begin, I share a story. At the 1924 Summer Olympics in Paris, France, Eric Little refused to run in the heats for which he was favored in the 100-meter race because they were held on a Sunday. He gave up his best races and instead trained for the 400-meter race. He won a gold medal for that race in 1924 Olympics in the 400-meter race, setting an Olympic record to the glorious cheers of thousands of people. For Eric Little, running was always, always second to his true calling, his faith and work as a missionary. And this is from the biography, For the Glory. Listen to the words of the theme song. We are destined for glory, far brighter than gold. In the race of a lifetime, swift and eager and bold. Eyes fixed on Jesus, strong feet run to follow, like chariots of fire. To hear God's well done and praise his name, our soul's highest goal. His pleasure is worth more than wealth or any fame that this earthly abode could give any one of us. After the Olympics, Eric Little returned to China as a missionary, teaching science and overseeing the sports program while sharing his faith in Jesus. Now, when he saw war with Japan on the horizon, Little put his children and his pregnant wife on a boat to Canada while he stayed behind. The opening lines of in the biography For the Glory finds Eric Little in a Japanese prison of war camp in 1944. Today, the book says, he is crouching on the starting line, scratched in the dirt with a stick. His body is slightly forward, his arms bent, and his left leg planted ahead of his right. He is ready for his launch. In Paris, he ran on a crimson cinder track in the prisoner of war camp. He runs on a dusty pathway laid out for the prisoners. It was a sports day in the camp, a way of forgetting his incarceration and all of their being held as prisoners of war. For the last 4 days of his life, separated from his family as a prisoner of war, Eric served his fellow prisoners, many of whom were children. He served them as a teacher, as a pastor, as a fellow worker and friend. He died of a brain tumor in the prison camp just before the war ended. He was 43 years old. Now, I read that story, which is a true story, because it reminds me of our two scripture passages today. It reminds me of why we, I hope, are Christians. Because we have come to know, just as the apostles did, the disciples of Jesus, have come to know what happened during that small, short 3 years, approximately 3 years, of Jesus' earthly ministry. And on the mountain that Jesus took Peter, James, and John up upon for that amazing transfiguration that happened. Now, none of us understand or can explain what happened there that day. Amen? We know because we have it recorded in three of the four Gospels. And as we think about what happened, God was showing the disciples and ultimately showing us, his church, showing us who claim Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, truly who he is. And in this passage, God says, "This is my beloved son. I love him, whom I love. Listen to him. Listen to him." And as we think about what that means when we are called to listen to Jesus, I think we are called as Eric Little was called. We are called to, first and foremost, profess faith in Jesus, Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. And as we draw into this relationship with Jesus, we come to understand that this is the purpose for which each one of us was created. Now, we have many gifts, each one of us. There are those here who share their gift of music, the gift of technology, the gift of hospitality, and those delicious sweets that we love to eat. Others of us are great listeners. We have prayer warriors in this congregation and in every congregation. And I believe that as we listen to the Spirit's movement, the Holy Spirit's movement, that we too are not as those which Paul was talking about, who have our spiritual eyes veiled. And not veiled, because as we open up to the Holy Spirit's moving in our lives, as we allow God to speak to us, then we are given a glimpse of glory. Because we live in the in-between time. We have God's word. We have the testimony of those who have come before us. We have the testimony in the New Testament, those who walked with Jesus and talked with Jesus. We have the testimony of those who were on that mountain and those who shared what happened as Jesus was transfigured, as Jesus became as pure of a white that ever was, not something that we can find or create or do here on earth, but that Jesus was transfigured by God, his Father. And I believe that, and I pray for us as Christians, that we are always seeking the reality of Jesus coming to us as God's Son. The reality of Jesus' ministry, a ministry that we remember, especially during this time of Lent that we are about to approach and journey through with Jesus, I pray. And that we come to understand, even in a deeper way perhaps, during Holy Week and Easter, the cross and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Because the cross is beckoning us, even on this Sunday of the Transfiguration. Because I believe the cross is part of the vision that we as the in-between, we as those who live in between Jesus' first coming and Jesus coming again, and what we do and how we live and how we share the gospel with all those that we have the privilege to serve, that is our call to action. That is, I believe, part of what God was saying to each one of us. This is my son, whom I love. Listen to him. Listen to him. May each of our hearts be open to listening to the power of the Holy Spirit to Jesus. And that what we do, how we interact with especially those we know and love, but even more so, those for whom God sends in our path, that we will share Christ, that we will reflect Christ, that we will reflect in some way the glory that God has been blessed and we've been blessed to receive from God, the glory of God, the glory of the risen Lord Jesus Christ in what we say and what we do. Amen. Amen. We're going to sing in response. I invite you to stand as we sing number 371. I stand amazed in the presence.
Oh,
Amen. Just one more. Amen. You may be seated. We come now to our sharing of our joys and our concerns. And I would direct your attention to your bulletin. And I think it is really good that the prayer concerns, the continued ones and the new ones, are printed in your bulletin each week. This is also a great place to inform your prayer time each day as you remember these. I won't go through them individually because I don't know them the way you do, but I would ask, are there anything in particular on these lists or others that you would like to hold up and share for prayer this day, as well as joys? Bill is having eye surgery. Yes. Others?
Ed Goodman's doing really well. He can walk better than he had for a couple of years with his knee now.
Is that Ed Goodman?
Yes.
Wonderful. Praise God. Oh, I'm sorry to hear that. Alan Myers. Family. Others. Amen. They are wonderful. I haven't seen any robins, although I guess some robins don't go anywhere except stay here over the winter, but I tend to not see them during the winter. But I think when I got in my car here this morning, I may have heard some. And the only downside of it being this beautiful is the things that happen right afterwards. And we have some forecast of that coming this week, so let's be grateful for the warmness, but also be watching if we have to be out on the roads, if there is ice or snow or whatever the weather brings. But thank you. Any others? I would pray for all of us that we, as we journey through the season of Lent, this yearly journey as we walk with Jesus through his ministry, and especially during the times that we are encouraged to look within our own hearts and our own journey of faith, that we might draw near to hearing Jesus speaking to our hearts. Any others? Then let us come to God in prayer. Gracious, loving, holy God, we do come into your presence in this time of prayer together as your church here at St. John's. We have shared some concerns this day both in our ongoing prayer list. But we've also shared some concerns that are even more recent, and we especially offer them up to you, O God. For many here in this congregation, there is grief and continued just seeking a double portion of your grace and love during the times of loss. We know, God, that you are the one constant within each of our lives, no matter what we face. And we also know that just as you were with Jesus as he was about to be tempted, and as he journeyed to the point in which he would be arrested and crucified, that you were and are always with him and with us. Oh God, we continue to pray for your spirit to guide us, for your presence to be made known in ways that maybe we are not even aware that we need to know you, oh God. I pray, God, all of this, and I would especially pray, God, for those who have prayers that are on their hearts this day that have not been voiced but have been voiced in silence, that each person knows that you hear, God, each prayer, and that those who pray in silence feel comfort and hope and reassurance. Oh God, we pray all of this. We pray it in the name of Jesus, who taught us that when we pray together, we pray, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." And I would remind you that even though we don't pass the offering plates, the basket is there for our weekly tithes and offerings and gifts to God. And I know that God blesses us in our giving and in our sharing to continue to support his working in this congregation and throughout the world. And now I would invite you to stand as we sing the doxology. Let us now pray together the prayer of dedication. Gracious God, as we remember Christ's transfiguration, we stand in awe of the glimpse of your glory revealed on the mountain, just as Peter, James, and John witnessed the radiant presence of Christ. We too are transformed by your love and grace. As we offer our tithes and offerings, may these gifts reflect the warming light of your love in our lives. Just as Jesus was transfigured before them, may our hearts be transformed and our actions reflect the love and truth Jesus embodies. Bless our giving and use it to bring your divine light to a world in need. In the name of Jesus our Lord, we pray. Amen. Let us continue with our final hymn, Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus. And we'll just sing that through once. 349. For my benediction, I'd like to read some of the words from the praise song, Shine, Jesus, Shine. I know that you probably have sung that here. And hear these words, because I can only imagine that the writer of this praise song was thinking and reflecting on the transfiguration and how the transfiguration of Jesus is spiritually internalized, I hope, in us. Lord, the light of your love is shining. In the midst of the darkness, shining. Jesus, light of the world, shine upon us. Set us free by the truth you now bring us. Shine on me. Shine on us. Shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory. Blaze, Spirit, blaze. Set our hearts on fire. Flow, river, flow. Flood the nations with grace and mercy. Send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light. Amen. May you go from this place shining with the light of God's glory, shining with the light of Christ's glory. May that shining of God's glory be made real and known in the ways that you live your life today, tomorrow, and for as much time as you are blessed. Amen. Amen.